Hello, everyone. My name is Cody Parkinson, and I'm an economist with the Bureau of Labor Statistics. And I'm excited today to talk to you about a new program here at the Bureau called the Student Monthly Labor Review. So the Student Monthly Labor Review is a pilot program that provides an opportunity for student authors to refine their analytical abilities, to receive comments from experienced professionals, to develop research conjectures for graduate study, to gain professional experience, and to produce new knowledge. So, the plan for today, I'm going to talk a little bit about the Bureau of Labor Statistics and the monthly labor review, and then we'll get into the details about the student monthly labor review. So we'll talk about some of the benefits of publishing, who can submit, and the submission requirements. So with that, we'll go ahead and we'll get started. So what is the Bureau of Labor Statistics, or BLS, or Bureau, as I might refer to it? Well, we are an agency within the U.S. Department of Labor. We are the principal fact-finding agency in the broad field of labor economics and statistics, and we serve as part of what's called the U.S. Federal Statistical System, which includes agencies like the Census Bureau and the Bureau of Economic Analysis. So we, the Bureau of Labor Statistics, measure labor market activity, working conditions, price changes, and productivity in the U.S. economy to support public and private decision making. I'd say we're probably most known for our data on employment and unemployment that comes out each month. So things like the unemployment rate and the number of jobs added or lost. But we're also the source of data on inflation, so how much the prices of goods and services have increased or decreased. In addition to those, however, we also publish data on time use, spending, productivity, workplace injuries, and much more. We're also an independent statistical agency, which means that we are apolitical and that our data and our methods are free from any political influence. And to kind of highlight this and give you some context about how we think when we publish data, we have a saying here that goes, the glass is not half full or half empty, rather it's an 8-ounce glass with 4 ounces of water. And we leave the subjective interpretation to others. So we produce a lot of data, but we also have to disseminate a lot of data. And one way we do that is through our flagship publication called the Monthly Labor Review, or MLR. The MLR was first published in 1915 and is the principal journal of fact, analysis, and research from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. Through MLR articles, experts from BLS join with private sector professionals and other government specialists to provide a wealth of research in a wide variety of economic-related fields. MLR articles will generally include at least some BLS data. We have many publications, but the MLR serves really as our outlet to look at data a bit deeper. So we use the MLR to identify emerging trends, to discuss innovative research or maybe new ways of looking at data. We use the MLR to provide information on a new method or methodology, but also just to write about interesting economic observations. So you might ask, well, who reads the MLR? MLR readers include everyone from researchers to lawmakers, businesses, employers, the media. So I'll say I actually work specifically in the press office here at the Bureau, and the media will frequently reach out about MLR articles and kind of use them as starting points for interesting stories. In general, MLR readers are typically a bit more data savvy than maybe readers of some of our other publications, but we are continually seeking to expand the MLR audience And the most recent example of those efforts is the topic of today's presentation, and that's the Student Monthly Labor Review. So the Student MLR is an opportunity for student authors to gain experience in research, writing, and to become a published author. And one of the primary goals of the Student MLR is to provide interesting and helpful information to readers. So the information we aim to provide includes research and analysis that focuses on issues that affect everyday people and their lives. And of course, the MLR does this already, but the Student MLR will continue these efforts. And I mean, we've had MLR articles written by college professors, by company presidents, experts from around the federal government. And we have articles discussing everything from the history of child labor to the evolution of how price change is measured. And we want you to add to that collection, really to write about topics that are interesting and important to you. So the Student MLR will publish original research and analysis on a wide range of economic topics. The Student Monthly Labor Review will broaden and diversify the scope of topics covered in the MLR and keep readers abreast of current research conducted by students from across the country. The Student MLR will be geared toward authors with innovative and novel ideas and approaches to research. Ultimately, we're looking to hear from student voices with new ideas. You may ask yourself, naturally, why should I submit an article? Why should I publish in the Student MLR? Well, there are many benefits, but one, you become an officially published author in a well-respected peer-reviewed journal, and then you can use that when applying for grad school or even a job in the future. In addition, BLS has millions of data users from around the world. In 2022, for example, the MLR averaged about 133,000 page views a month. As the principal fact-finding agency in the broad field of labor economics, publishing with BLS in the Student MLR will give your research exposure to readers from around the world. Publishing with BLS and the Student MLR will also help you to establish professional relationships with BLS staff who can help you really through the process of paper submission, of editing, of publication. And these professional relationships will support you in developing your capacities in research, analysis, and writing. And I mentioned this at the beginning, but again, the Student MLR will provide you with an opportunity to refine your analytical abilities, to receive comments from experienced professionals, to develop your research conjectures for graduate study, to gain professional experience, and to produce new knowledge. This program really is a great first step into the economic publication world. So we've talked about some of the benefits of publishing, so I'm sure you're thinking, great, I want in. Who can publish in the Student MLR? Well, great question. In short, any currently enrolled college student in an undergraduate or terminal master's program can submit a paper. The topic, of course, has to be relevant and use at least some BLS data, but students in any field of degree can submit a paper. And I'll point out the street sign here on this slide, which of course has economics, but also medical, law, literature, management. You are not limited by your field of degree. We know that data analysis and writing skills are becoming increasingly important in today's job market. And we've identified a gap in existing opportunities for undergraduate and terminal master's students. So currently, undergraduate and master's students have very few opportunities to publish their research, and the Student MLR is a great way to get your research published. Let's talk about the submission requirements and guidelines. So all articles need approval from a professor or department chair, and this is to ensure that papers have gone through some form of review process. So already graded papers are great in part because they've already been vetted and refined to some degree. And this increases the likelihood of a submission being accepted and published. We will not accept any abstracts or theses. And like we discussed earlier, the paper should involve data analysis and be a description of emerging trends or innovative research, an interesting economic observation, or a new method or methodology. Again, data analysis is required. We want to avoid any unsubstantiated theory or conjecture. Articles also need to be free of any personal opinions and should not advocate for or against any policy. Articles, of course, need to be your own original work. There are also a number of submission guidelines that you should be aware of. These are things like file formats and citations. And we have detailed information posted online at www.bls.gov/opub/mlr/4-authors.htm. Super short web address, really easy to remember, but just in case, it's here on the slide. We also need a completed submission form, which we will go over now. Here is the top of the submission form. We'll start with your contact info. We think it's really important to have your name for this whole process, so we ask for that first. We also ask for your email, as well as your advisor's name and their email. Then we ask that you check a box on who's submitting the paper. We also ask for some education information, so the name of your university, your major, your expected graduation date, your year in school, and then your degree type, so whether you're an undergraduate or master's student. And then here's the bottom of the submission form. So we ask for the paper title, the abstract, and we ask that you limit it to 150 words. We also ask for your signature and your advisor's signature, simply affirming that the article is your original work, that it was written by the named individuals, that all contributors and references are properly credited, and that you have the rights to the work and that it's not been published elsewhere. Apologies in advance. This slide is very long, but it has a lot of really useful information, so bear with me. So you've got your paper written, it's been approved, all of the files are ready to go, and you submit your article to the student MLR. Well, what happens after that? So to start in the confirmation phase, once an article is submitted, we will begin by making sure that we have all of the basic information and forms that we need as part of the submission. If anything is missing, we'll let you know. So for example, if the submission form is missing, or proper approvals have not been obtained, we will ask for these. We will also do a quick read of the article just to make sure it has all of the main parts, like a title. And again, if any of these are missing, we'll ask for them because they're all important for the next step of the process. So the next step of the process is the reviewed for acceptance step. This is where we will read the article to determine its publishability and acceptance in the student MLR. And I want to emphasize this point. Our goal is to let you know if the paper will be accepted within 8 weeks of submission. If the paper is not initially accepted, we will provide reasons why and possible ways for the paper to be improved and accepted. If we do accept, then we'll let you know and also ask for any revisions. So revisions at this point will be focused on structural or factual issues with the article and not necessarily grammar-related types of changes, because those will come later during the editorial process. So then we move into the editing process. So what are we looking for when we edit? Well, we're looking for things like grammar and tone and style. This is where we dot our I's and cross our T's, but it's more than just that. The editorial process is very, very detailed. There may be edits to an entire sentence to clarify the message. There may be feedback on the way a chunk of an article is organized, or we might ask for more information or sources for a particular point in the article. This is also the step in the process that for many authors is the most challenging or even the most frustrating, because oftentimes the author will likely see more edits or recommendations for changes than they expected. And I'll say I've done some writing that has gone through MLR editors, and I think I'm a good writer, not a great writer, but a good writer. And there are always many edits with lots of red when I get my writing back. But I'll say the edits are always very good and very thorough. And I think of it like this. The editors are making me sound smarter through their edits and then putting my name on the paper. So I can't complain too much. Ultimately, the goal of the editor is to ensure that the article is well understood by readers, that it maintains consistency, and that it guarantees that we conform to mandated accessibility rules and guidelines. The editors are on your side. In the finalized phase, a BLS editor and you, the author, will discuss edits and make any final changes to get the article ready for publication. And then the article is published. After your article is published, it doesn't just hide somewhere on a government website, it gets promoted. So it'll be featured on the BLS.gov homepage, a tweet, sometimes two will be sent out, hooray, technology, an email to our subscribers will be sent, and it also gets referenced again in the Friday publications email. And even above all this, I'd argue you could send a text to your grandma, let her know that you're an officially published author. Some might argue that that's the best promotion, but overall, your article does get promoted in many ways. So we've gone over a little bit about the Bureau of Labor Statistics and the monthly labor review, and then we've provided detailed information about this exciting new student MLR project. And that will conclude today's information session. So I want to thank you all for watching this recorded version. If you have questions about this program, please send us an email at studentmlr@bls.gov. Thanks again.